Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wildberger, and this is part of a series where we're looking at sociology and pure mathematics. Today I want to talk about a famous paradox called the Banach Tarski paradox, or sometimes the Banach Tarski theorem, and I want to ask, is it actually nonsense? So this is actually from my blog. So I have a blog called NJ Wildberger Tangential Thoughts. You can find it at njwildberger.com. And about some 5 or 6 years ago, I posted this blog post called The Banach Tarski Paradox, Is It Nonsense? And I propose to read it to you, it's not that long, and then we can have a little bit of a discussion. Okay, so here is my blog. The Banach Tarski Paradox, Is It Nonsense? How can you tell when your theory has overstepped the bounds of reasonableness? How about when you start telling people your facts and their faces register with incredulity and disbelief? That is the response of most reasonable people when they hear about the Banach Tarski paradox. From Wikipedia, the Banach Tarski paradox states that a ball in the ordinary Euclidean space can be doubled using only the operations of partitioning into subsets, replacing a set with a congruent set, and reassembly. The theorem is commonly phrased in terms of two solid balls, one twice the radius of the other, in which case it asserts that we can subdivide the smaller ball into a small number, usually 5, of disjoint subsets, perform rigid motions, which are combinations of translations and rotations, to these sets and obtain a partition of the larger ball, or a couple of balls the same size as the original. It is to be emphasized that these are cut and paste congruences. This was first stated by S. Banach and A. Tarski in 1924, building on earlier work of Vitali and Hausdorff. This theorem contradicts common sense. In real life, we know that it is not easy to get something from nothing. We cannot take $1, subtly rearrange it in some clever fashion, and end up with $2. It doesn't work. That is why most ordinary people, when they hear about this kind of result, are at first disbelieving, and then, when told the proof involves free groups of rotations and the axiom of choice, and that the resulting sets are in fact impossible to write down explicitly, just shake their heads. Those pure mathematicians, boy, they are smart, but what arcane things they get up to. This theorem is highly dubious. It really ought to be taken with a grain of salt, or at least generate some controversy. This kind of logical ledger domain probably should not go unchallenged for decades. The logical flaws involved in the usual argument are actually quite numerous. First, there are confusions about what free groups are and how we specify them. An underlying theory of infinite sets is assumed, but as usual, a coherent theory of such infinite sets is missing. Then there is a claim that free groups can be found inside the group of rotations of three-dimensional space. This usually involves some discussion involving real numbers and irrational rotations. All the usual difficulties with real numbers that students of my YouTube series Math Foundations will be familiar with immediately bear down. And then finally, there is an appeal to the axiom of choice from the ZFC Axiom Fest, which claims that one can make an infinite number of independent choices. But this contradicts the law of logical honesty that I put forward several days ago from the blog post. I remind you that this was the idea: don't pretend that you can do something that you can't. You cannot make an infinite number of independent choices. Cannot, impossible, never could, never will be able to. No amount of practice will help. Whistling while you do it won't make it happen. You cannot make an infinite number of independent choices. So we ought not to pretend that we can. That is what the law of logical honesty asserts. We can't just say, And now let's suppose that we can make an infinite number of independent choices. That is just an empty phrase if we cannot support it in ways that people can observe and validate. The actual sets involved in the case of transforming a ball of radius 1 to a ball of radius 2 are not sets that one can write down in any meaningful way. They exist only in a kind of no man's land of speculative thinking, entirely dependent on these set theoretic assumptions that pin them up. Ask for a concrete example and explicit specifications, and you only get smiles and shrugs. And so the Banach Tarski nonsense has no practical application. There is no corresponding finite version that helps us to do anything useful, at least none that I know of. It is something like a modern mathematical fairy tale. Shouldn't we be discussing this kind of thing more vigorously here in Pure Mathematics? Now, since this is a lecture for sociological types, I'm not going to go into the mathematical details. The actual argument of the paradox or theorem is actually quite subtle, and it's actually quite interesting. It's just that the framework that it's built upon is a faulty framework, and so no amount of ingenuity and cleverness will transcend that essential difficulty. But I do want to talk a little bit about that framework, you know, and to give you an idea of what actually the problems are and the sociological aspects of this dichotomy that we have towards a result like this. So a crucial question is, what is a ball? A three-dimensional ball, what is that mathematically? So here is the standard modern version of what the ball is, say the unit ball, let's call it B1. It's in terms of a set, so it's a set of objects which are points in three-dimensional space with three elements x, y, and z. So they're objects like this where the elements x, y, and z belong to the so-called real numbers. That's the default arithmetical system upon which modern pure mathematics is based. Subject, however, to the relation that x squared plus y squared plus z squared should be less than or equal to 1. Now, when we see something like this, or when you see it, what are you supposed to think? What does this actually mean? Well, let me try to flesh out a little bit about, you know, what the nature of this might be. Okay, so it's a set. So first of all, there should be some braces because that's how we usually denote sets. Okay, and the elements of the sets are these triples of numbers. So here's the first triple. There's a square brackets and there's an x coordinate, a y coordinate, and a z coordinate. So this first x coordinate is 0.512 dot dot dot. So there's some decimal, typically an infinite decimal, that starts 512 and then it goes on in some fashion, and it's not clear what that fashion is. And then the next one, the y-coordinate is 0.317 dot dot dot, and then the z-coordinate is minus 0.12009 dot dot dot. Now this is obviously inadequate because these are potentially infinite decimals and we haven't specified how they continue past the first three or four digits. So what we really need to make sense of something like this is some additional information, and I've denoted that by these sort of asterisk footnotes. So corresponding to this thing, there should be a footnote somewhere that explains what is the rule or the procedure or the computer program that generates the digits of this first x real number. And similarly, for all the subsequent real numbers that appear, and also for subsequent points, there should be corresponding footnotes somewhere where you can read what the algorithms are that generate these supposed infinite decimals. Now, if we call this one, say, P1, that's the first point, and then here's P2, the second point, then with this approach, we could then potentially list such triples, and maybe we could have an argument that we could, you know, have every point that satisfies this condition being on this list. So this is kind of one interpretation. It's an interpretation that's oriented towards a computer scientist or engineer that wants things to be tied down to some computation, like a computer program somewhere. However, such a listing is only a goal if we restrict to computable real numbers. So the kinds of decimals that I'm talking about that are generated by computer programs are called computable real numbers in the standard story. And for the purposes of the Banach Tarski argument, they're not enough. Okay, so this view of what the ball is inadequate to make the argument of Banach Tarski work. You need a broader understanding, a bigger picture than this sort of computational point of view. Now, it might surprise you social scientists to learn that most pure mathematicians do not ascribe to a computational approach to infinite decimals. That is seen as, first of all, limiting, and also necessarily gets embroiled in the problem that computer scientists have in delineating what exactly is an algorithm and how to tell whether two different algorithms are essentially equivalent. So there's a whole can of worms that the computer scientists have been thinking about for decades, and pure mathematicians want to steer clear from that. Okay? So in fact, we don't go down that route. We rather go down a different route, and that's epitomized by this adjective choice. We have a choice approach to real numbers or infinite decimals. And what does that mean? Okay, that means that this is more like what's in the minds of pure mathematicians when they think about the unit ball. So here is our first point, okay? Or maybe not first point, we shouldn't say first point. Here is a point. And now it's 0.742 dot dot dot, 0.214 dot dot dot, 0.380 dot dot dot. And if you inquire as to what the pattern is, there's no pattern. We're assuming that there's an oracle or something that can generate subsequent digits of this decimal, perhaps without any rhyme or reason. So without necessarily a finite computer program generating it. That's the fundamental idea, that we're talking about infinite sequences which are not necessarily generated by computers. So necessarily, if you want to imagine that, okay, maybe you have to imagine an oracle or some creature outside of our universe with an infinite amount of computing resources, an infinite amount of memory, an infinite amount of brain power. So that's one of the points. And then there is a whole bunch of points like this. But crucially, when you go to this larger choice point of view, you are no longer able to list the points, first one, second one, third one, etc. You are forced to index the points in a much more subtle way. Let me show you what happens. So this first one here, it appears to be the first one, but we're not going to call it number one. It's a point which is itself indexed by a sequence, but it's an infinite sequence. To make life simple, let's choose a binary sequence, okay? So I'm going to choose some binary sequence. 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, dot, dot, dot. And this point then is the point which is indexed by this infinite label. Okay, so this next one here, which appears to be the next one, but it's some other sequence, maybe 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, dot, dot, dot. Now you may say, well, what is the sequence here? What's the rule to this sequence? Again, there's no rule. Okay, so we're obliged to create one of these points for every sequence that our oracle is able to generate using zeros and ones in a completely arbitrary way. So the points are indexed themselves by infinite choice sequences, and the entries, these real numbers which are appearing here, are also choice real numbers. That is, they are not given by finite algorithms. I hope you can see, without having to go further, that we have completely disconnected ourselves from computational reality here. We're playing this mind game, okay, involving these things which cannot be written down, which cannot be specified concretely, that require us to think about oracles or some other infinite creatures, possibly outside our universe. It's all like a major fantasy, okay? But nevertheless, this is the framework in which the argument of Banach and Tarski takes place. Okay, so it's once you set up this, then you can start, or then you do start talking about subdividing a ball like this into five sets and making some argument that you can then take these five appropriate sets or whatever and make some transformations and then rearrange to get the ball of radius 2. So you cannot really write anything down. So there's no way of connecting this to actual physical reality. There's no way of illustrating the theorem. There's no way of demonstrating it. There's no finite dimensional analogs. In my opinion, it's nonsense. It's nonsense. And it's a really interesting sociological question about, you know, how can it be that something which is so self-evidently almost silly is supported by the establishment for decades and decades? The reason is that the underlying sort of set theory that's involved here is essential for all kinds of other things in pure mathematics. So if we abandoned this approach here, we would have to change or modify all kinds of other things, all kinds of analysis, topology, differential geometry, algebraic geometry, other fields too. That would be very threatening. People don't want to do that. So they're maintaining the status quo. They want to believe in this orthodoxy, even though it's, I think to a layperson, obviously a little bit silly. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.